όσο είναι ένα μεγόσπορο, σε ένα σπούδιμα, διαλύσεις τις διότιμες. First of all, I would like to welcome and thank you for joining us to the heading of the Suicide Fila, as well as to all of those who are watching us in live stream on the channel. My name is Ina Krstic, and I'm a senior research associate at the Pilar Institute, and I'm the head of the research project that is exploring emotion in the reconstruction of diaspora identity across in Australia and New Zealand from 1995 to 1991, within which today's lecture is organized. Seven members research team, as well as in front of the co-organizers of this event, the Pilar Institute and the Croatian Student Institute. I'm particularly happy that we can host our today's lecture, Dr. Professor Mariusz Smaszek, and I'm sure that we will enjoy the presentation. But first, I would like to invite Dr. Mariusz, the director of the Pilar Institute, to say a couple of words. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure to welcome you to the Ivo Pilar Institute of Social Sciences and to announce a lecture given by Professor Mariusz Smaszek at the University of Belfast. This year, the Pilar Institute will be celebrating 30 years of its research activity. As the leading public institute in the field of social sciences in Croatia, we have about 100 employees working at our administrative center in Zagreb and local centers to operation. Our scientists participate in a lot of projects in the European research area and in other forms of international collaboration and cooperation. At the same time, they provide intellectual support to development processes through operation. Research-generated knowledge has been the mission of the Institute of this foundation. The coronavirus pandemic reminded us that we are fragile, that we can do nothing without hope, that the human spirit and emotions have value in public space, and that not only medical, but also social, economic, cultural, and other dimensions of the pandemic are also. Since the beginning of the pandemic, the Institute has been involved in its scientific evaluation from the point of view of the social sciences. For example, in the spring of 2020, the Institute team participated in an international study on the social and psychological aspects of the pandemic launched by New York University. In July of this year, a thematic issue of our journal, Društvena istraživanja, on the psychosocial aspects of COVID-19 pandemic, such as social isolation, mental health, etc., was published. The Institute also has a lot of experience in research work on humanistic phenomena in correlation with social sciences, as represented, for example, a project of the Croatian Science Foundation dedicated to the research work on emotions in the reconstruction of identity of Croatian diaspora in Australia and New Zealand. As part of the project activities, today we have special honor and privilege to host Professor Smaszek, who will give a lecture on researching human effect and emotions in pandemic and pre-pandemic times. Zagreb, and a special welcome. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Kurutz. And as I and as well as Professor Kurutz said, today's lecture is organized in the research project exploring emotions in the reconstruction of diaspora identity. And it is a 5-year long project from 2021 to 2026, which is funded by the Croatian Science Foundation. The purpose of the project is to explore the role of emotions in the development of transnational power communities through the analysis of the history of Croatian communities in Australia and New Zealand from ancient period. The basic theoretical and methodological framework of the research is settled in the concept of emotions. And in doing so, emotions could be approached as the basis of migrants' identities. We believe that the research will provide a broader and deeper understanding of the phenomenon of migrations as one of the key aspects of. Which are ideas, space, object, and gender. However, considering that the theoretical framework of the history of emotions has not been so far systematically operationalized in the studies of migration history, which is particularly the case in regarding the Croatian historiography, the sociological and anthropological insights provide us with initial understanding of the basic emotions we expect. And this brings us to today's guest lecture, Dr. Professor Maruša Vasović. When we were writing the project application, we cited her works, having no idea that we will meet her and collaborate with her very soon. Dr. Vasović holds a PhD in anthropology from the University of Amsterdam and currently works at the Queen's University in Belfast. She published extensively on the topic of migrations and emotions and edited and quite a number of books on the topic. This was the result of her primary interest in culture production, emotion dynamics, and globalizing forces. At present, she is working on a book on art and politics in Czechoslovakia and Czech Republic, and is investigating the effects of the coronavirus pandemic on the lives of migrants in Italy. Personally, and I have to add this, I'm particularly happy she's here with us today because of her openness and, I would say, easygoingness in communication. About 5-6 months ago, I sent Professor Svashek an introductory and an invitation, first email, basically out of nowhere. And in Croatia, we would use expression APP, project project. Saying basically, hi, we are interested in what are you doing? Please find us something about the project. And we would like you to come over for a lecture, roundtable, and a workshop. Her reply was very short and concise, and now I'm quoting her. Nice hearing from you. I'd be delighted to come to Zagreb to give a lecture and discuss your present project with you. When are you planning the event? And that was a good calling. Of course, we were so super happy, and we are very grateful about it, considering all the circumstances in these complicated times we live in, pandemic, and everything. I hope this type of guest lectures will become an kind of annual tradition. While we plan to organize the arrival of renowned scholars with the expertise in the topic every year, as long as the project lasts. So, Professor Svashek, thank you once again, and thank you all for joining us, and I'm sure you enjoyed our lecture.
Well, thank you so much. I'm delighted to be here. I'm going to read my paper, speed things up. I won't talk very fast, but I'm a non-native English speaker, so although I've been for 22 years in Belfast and teaching in English, I think especially for this kind of exchange, it's useful if I read my don't mind. So first of all, of course, I would like to thank Ivan, and also the Institute of Social Sciences for this for inviting me to this lecture, to give this lecture. And of course, it's a great opportunity to connect with you in front of me. I felt that probably I should start thinking more about emotions and about the theorization of emotions. And I developed a multidimensional approach to emotional dynamics. So, basically, looking at emotions as discourses, as practices that can be performed here, and also as embodied experiences. So I put some names also of scholars that I've been inspired by. I don't have the time yet to tell you more about that. I'm sure you recognize some of these names. And just as an example, to make it more concrete, we could think about love, for example, as a discourse, as a performative practice, and as an embodied experience. So thinking about just many different types of love, discourses about love, love for the homeland, romantic love, family, friends, just to name a few. But thinking about love for the homeland, think about certain discourses that produce knowledge and subjectivity plus moral expectations, say in connection to the motherland. Okay? And of course, the motherland, the term itself, it's a kinship term. So it already implies a lot of things about how this love should be taking place and experienced. So then, of course, if you think again about the homeland and about practices, how do we practice love for the homeland? Well, often it's done through annual celebrations, waving of flags and all of that. Now you can say it's performative because waving a flag doesn't mean that you actually feel that love for homeland, but you know how it should be expressed. So there's this kind of dynamics of performance. And then another important dimension is then the embodied experience, which would then, in relation to the homeland, love for the homeland, which would all sorts of sensorial and bodily sensations that are felt, expressed, but also some are automatic, some are learned. So say, for example, you get a national anthem, and whether you want it or not, you feel moved by it. So it's clearly something that you learned from a very long time ago. It's tied in with discourses, with practices, with performances, and with your body experience. So then another way in which I started thinking about emotions was in further research, not only on sedated German diaspora, but also on migrant families of different backgrounds in Northern Ireland, and also on the production and use of art and artifacts in diaspora and other settings. So some of the ideas that I developed had to do with the moving subjects, moving objects. So basically people and thing dynamics, where I started using the idea of transition to refer to objects, where objects might change in meaning, in value, in financial value, and also impact, which can be emotional impact. And transformation has started to refer to changes in people who interact and produce artifacts, and who in that process of interaction with those objects change subjectivity, identification, performance of self, and so on. So again, I know this is highly theoretical, but thinking again about this idea of the love for the homeland, you could think about a Yugoslav or a Croatian flag that's taken to museums by migrants, and the object itself has some slightly different meaning in this diaspora context as if you compare it to what it means at home. And also how people waving the flag project their identity is different if you're Croatian, Croatian, or Croatian dance. So this is kind of the way in which I try to tie up things. You can also think about all sorts of other objects, photographs, artworks, and so on. I think this approach is quite useful. So then we move on to affect. Now, affect is a huge kind of philosophical debate about what is it, what's it, what, how can it be defined. But I started looking at it, particularly as I get later in my interest in communication technology. But let me explain. So affective relationality, how I define it, is it's about the interplay of forces within and between humans and between human and non-human phenomena. So we can think about certain affective environments as together in this building, their masks on and off and the technology. So you could say there's a particular affected environment. And you can think about all sorts of forces, so human bodies, buildings, artifacts, technology, but also temperature, the winds, the humidity, and so on. So these are all kind of interacting forces of affecting and being affected. And within that, there are also emotions being evoked, played out, managed, maybe regimes of emotions being played out. Which means that affect, not all affects are emotions. Emotions emerge in this affective environment. So think again about the love for the homeland, and say a smell, a certain smell and a certain sound. Now there's lots of smells and sounds, but only some might evoke a longing for the homeland, or maybe a hatred of the homeland, or whatever. So you can see there's all these affective forces in emotions are part of that. That's how I would approach it. So my approach to affect and emotions does not, as some theorists have done, define affect as pre-cognitive intensity, which becomes known through the named emotion. In contrast, I employ the notion of affect relationality to explore the interplay of forces within and between humans, and between human and human, non-human phenomena. So from this relational perspective, stomach ache that causes pain, distress, and maybe also anger is affect, is an affective process. For the act of blowing up a balloon, there's air pressure that increases the size of this balloon. And then it might trigger a smile on a child's face, which in that sense, the latter sense would be an emotional reaction. And of course, virus, which results in illness and death, is also part, you can see that as an affective relational process. And coming to communication technology, the tapping on a phone to send a text, which might be meant to make somebody smile, is all playing together in that field. So, just a few words about my pre-pandemic research. So you can see here, there's one report, research report, and also a chapter in a book that deal with my research on transnational family life, which was published in those two, the report and the chapter, where I started thinking about affect and affect relationality and so on. And then this is very recent research. It's built on the pre-pandemic transnational family research, which is focused on, so both these two, the sort of the lockdown routines, a chapter coming out to the right. And then I've done some work on these creative digital methodologies, which is work that is now under review and hopefully to be published in a journal. That's very much this focuses on the pandemic. So let's then move on to another part of the second part of this talk. So the global pandemic produced a situation in which globally, the globally spreading coronavirus forced large numbers of human beings into spatial immobility as they attempted to counter its deadly impact. These static swings, disallowing children to freely interact and play, are a sad reminder of the drastic measurements of governments that governments around the world take. The pandemic is, of course, far from ending, and many factors play a role. The appearance of new viral variants as a result of genetic mutations, the unequal distribution of vaccines across the world, and spreading of fake news about the risk of vaccination. Now, my presentation takes us back to the first few months after the arrival of the virus in Northern Ireland, February 2020. So by mid-March, Queen's University in Belfast closed its doors, and we were required to work from home. In my country of birth, the Netherlands, The Dutch government also implemented lockdown policy, urging people to stay at home and keep a safe distance when shopping. Houd afstand, keep distance. When bound to home, I did what many other people did, me being a migrant particularly. I called my close relatives to make sure they were okay. I spoke most frequently with my elder sister Mariana, who was based in the Netherlands, our country of birth many miles away. Any chance that my sister and I would meet within the foreseeable future seemed zero at the time. Travel restrictions in both countries ruled out international travel, and the travel ban was not going to be lifted anytime soon. Bound to home, we also communicated frequently through WhatsApp and Skype, and I soon started painting her as we were chatting online. So I was partly driven to do so because I missed the face-to-face life drawing classes that I attended before lockdown. So you see here the last two works that I made when I was still going to classes and painting models. Now I also began to see long-distance paintings as a way to connect and to reconnect with friends and members of my transnational family. Some examples here, and you can see that I also always included the communication devices themselves in my paintings, for the laptops and mobile phones, as these were active agents and affective agents that co-constituted this affective environment. So when the lockdown continued, I found myself reaching out more regularly than usual to relatives living in my country of birth in other countries. And I soon wondered how the pandemic was affecting the ways in which other transnational families use communication technologies. To what extent did forced immobility produce new routines of long-distance emotional interaction and virtual care? I began to explore the experiences of six migrant women aged between 29 and 58, all living on the island of Ireland. So two are from the US, and the others were born in different European countries. So before I go to my the questions in this research, just some other paintings of friends and family, including then those technologies themselves. So here are the questions I started asking. How did these migrant women already experienced in the use of long-distance communication technologies to overcome physical separation with their distant relatives in the homeland, adapt their use of these technologies during lockdown? Bound to their homes in their new countries of settlement, how did they respond to the new spatial-temporal reality of forced confinement, developing new ways to engage with members of their household, with neighbors and local colleagues and friends? Then spending most of their time in and around their homes, to what extent did their use and perception of local spaces change? It is important to note that all of my interlocutors were in a relatively good position to deal with the crisis. Home ownership and jobs that we continue to do from home secured relatively comfortable lives in isolation. Access to digital technology and relative financial security ensured ongoing long-distance communication. Our situation was worlds apart from precarious circumstances faced by many migrants, asylum seekers, and refugees. Driven away from their home regions and homelands by economic deprivation and political instability, and in numerous cases lacking legal status and a roof above their heads, many uprooted families found themselves in highly vulnerable positions, doubting whether they would ever meet their dispersed relatives, even in post-pandemic times. Now, despite these vast differences, which have to be acknowledged, the COVID-19 crisis has posed challenges to all humans. The highly contagious disease has demanded new ways of coping with a radically changed dynamics of proximity and distance at a time when close contact can be deadly. Commenting on the crisis situation in Italy in March 2020, Sociologist Marco Pedroni argued that to gain a nuanced picture of the lockdown, it is necessary to produce, and I quote, a micro-sociology of everyday lives, exploring people's individual routines. Pedroni identified five contrasting factors that should be taken into account, dividing people into groups of people with caring responsibilities versus people without, people required to work outside versus people who work from home, people who can keep their, who could keep their job and salary versus people fearing that they might lose it or have already lost their jobs, people living in comfortable houses versus those in confined tiny flats and decaying public housing, and then finally people owning the cultural and economic resources to access and use digital technologies versus people who have no possibility. Now my paper adds a sixth division to the ones identified by Pedroni. So that's the last one here. So the distinction between people whose family members live nearby and those who live at a geographical distance. And the transnational families at the center of my research fit them in the latter category. Like many others across the globe, the migrant women relied on communication technologies to move around virtual worlds to meet up with distant kin. Their digital activities co-constituted an affective environment in which human and non-human agency shaped existing and newly emerging routines of virtual sociality, care, and emotional interaction. The unique situation can be understood as a triad of interacting affective forces that manifested themselves as dynamic assemblages of people, communication devices, and viruses. I conceptualize this process, as I've already mentioned earlier, as a relational field in which individuals continue to provide long distance support in a changed social, spatial, material, and viral environment. So, and of course, these women would not only be drawing on pre-pandemic discourses, practices, and embodied experiences of transnational family care, but they also reacted to the specific opportunities and limitations posed by the lockdown and available technologies. And I was particularly interested in the long distance emotional dynamics of care and interaction and support. So the central question was then how different communication devices shaped old and newly emerging routines of long distance sociality and emotional support. Bearing in mind Pedroni's five contrasting factors, all research participants, as I said, were settled and found themselves in relatively secure positions, were able to work from home, felt responsible for the well-being of at least some relatives in the home. Four of the women in my group, in the research group, had care obligations for young or teenage children, and all had access to computers and mobile phones. Their new lockdown routines, I did in many interviews with them and all sorts of other long distance interviewing research kind of methods that I developed, and I'll come back to that later. But their lockdown routines showed a number of emerging patterns described here as continuation, intensification, innovation, and distancing. So continuation alludes to the ongoing routines of pre-crisis activities. One of the women, for example, said, being migrants, not much has changed. We normally talk online with family back home and have done so for a long time. It's been 15 years since we started using Skype. So for many years, this woman had video calls with her parents every Sunday, keeping the tradition going with her dad after her mom had died. So with regard to intensification, the women noted that at the beginning of lockdown, they had intensified their use of long-distance communication technology to provide emotional support and also, of course, get emotional support. One woman who said that she had started using Skype and Messenger more frequently than before was very concerned about her mother, a teacher, who was still going to work. So she says, "I was worried that my mom would catch the coronavirus. Given that she's a heavy smoker and has hypertension, she's in a risk group. So at the beginning of that crisis, I was calling her repeatedly over Skype. And I was then very relieved when the government decided to close the schools. She also contacted her sister to negotiate care arrangements." So she says, "I started contacting my sister more often via Messenger because I was hoping my mom could possibly go over to where she lives, a small town, which is much safer than Warsaw." This was actually a Polish person. "But unfortunately, the risk of traveling on public transport was too high." So you see this kind of negotiation also of care, which is an emotional act in itself. And you can see also the significance of this communication technology to make this. So also wondering how long it would take before her young toddler would be able to see his granny, she started to send daily photographs of her son to her mother using her mobile phone. So again, these devices were very important. Now, with regard to innovation, the need to come up with alternative ways of long-distance support and emotional interaction was particularly felt when a distant family member became infected, or during regular annual celebrations that had structured family dynamics for generations. And of course, some of those annual celebrations are also linked to homeland discourses. One of the women said that, and I quote, "During Easter, one thing really changed. We decided with my dad, my sister, and her partner, we have shared Easter breakfast using Skype conference. In both locations, we were sitting around a table with a laptop. It had no real resemblance of sitting together around the same table, but it did create a sense of celebration. Communication was awkward because the sound quality was bad, but doing it marked the extraordinariness of Easter time. So the action was more important than the quality of the exchange." Now, in normal circumstances, this woman and her family would have traveled to her homeland to celebrate Easter together, but of course it wasn't possible. Other forms of digital engagement with distant relatives that were newly introduced by the women in the study included meeting up for online quizzes and drinks, joining Zoom classes together, communication about imaginary visits to the homeland using Google Earth, hanging out on Skype or Zoom while being engaged in separate activities. In addition to the more lighthearted innovations, the women also used mobile phones to speak with people infected by COVID, and in one case with a relevant group. In the end, died in the hospital. Now let's move on to the idea of distancing. So distancing refers to moments when some women in the study experienced alienation between themselves and their geographically distant relatives. Distancing counters the illusion of an unproblematic, happy digital world in which long-distance family relations always flourish. Ashley, a 30-year-old researcher, hit the nail on the head, and she's American. She hit the nail on the head when she wrote, "Weeks into my country's COVID-19-related shutdowns and months into the global crisis, I've realized that my communication with my family haven't fundamentally changed during the pandemic. A lot of the discussion I see online romanticizes the notion of humans as social animals, discussing our deep-seated need for connection, suggesting that we turn to technologies like Zoom to make up for the lack of touch, the face-to-face conversations with those close to us. I find these discourses to be limited and more than a little naive. I have a family who can kindly be described as difficult, And so my own experience is much more complicated. So I think this is interesting, and also for those of you doing research on migrants and transnational family life, of course we have to look into those tensions between people over there and over here, and also different generations and how they feel for and connect to what is supposed to be the homeland, whatever that means. Now, this American interlocutor describes how over the years, radically different views on politics and religion had resulted in a routine of social disengagement between her and her family. So while not unloving, it comprised little emotional interaction. COVID-19 had paradoxically both intensified contact and reinforced the sense of distance. So she noted, just because you don't get on with someone doesn't mean you don't worry about them. And I think that's also a very interesting insight. Another woman also alluded to a sense of alienation between herself and her relatives back home. Despite her renewed contact with her cousins, her relatives were much closer to each other than with her. She was the only person in the family who had given up religion. She had mixed feelings when one of her relatives rang to talk about the recent death of an in-law who had been infected with COVID-19 and who had died in an American hospital. Close to tears, this relative who had phoned her told her that they had gathered in the hospital car park, having to say goodbye by phone. And she reacted with empathy, suppressing emotional ambiguity that emerged as she knew that, and I quote her now, she only called me because she could not get anyone else on the phone. She would have wanted to hear, she's in heaven now, but I couldn't say that, I'm not religious. So again, I think this is an interesting kind of insight into this complexity of emotions that emerge and tensions that also might be maintained. Okay, so I can go on and on, but I'm also aware of time. So let's just move on to the last theme of this lecture, and then we can maybe have some discussion if there's time. So let's think a bit about the use of methods during research at this moment when we cannot really interview our people and maybe also not go to archives. But this is basically about interaction between researchers and interlocutors. Mia stands in front of her laptop in her room in Belfast, facing the camera. She's a 27-year-old PhD student from Germany who moved to Northern Ireland some years ago with her husband. She decided to get pregnant when the pandemic situation temporarily ended her research project in March 2020. I asked her to turn her body so that I can see the shape of her pregnant belly. I have known her for several years, but we have not been able to meet her face to face since the start of the first lockdown. She's close to her due date, and her flowery dress accentuates the roundness of her body. Beautiful, I say. Can I take another picture? It is January 2021, and we are meeting on Skype. A week ago, she enthusiastically agreed to my suggestion to photograph her again for a series of long-distance paintings that I have been working on since the start of the pandemic. Tim Ingold, who's an anthropologist, has emphasized the processual nature of making, investigating the ongoing process of material transformation, affordance, and entanglement. In the case of long-distance painting, these dynamics constitute interacting technical, material, social, and emotional processes. First, the method of making, in the sense here of painting, it transforms the computer screen into an interactive social visual frame that affords compositional choices. This was, in this case, a collaborative process, as my interlocutor models could check what was visible on the screen, because they could, of course, see how I saw them through this Skype, and also suggest certain changes. The second, The emergence of lines and shapes was essential to long-distance social interaction. The appearance of visual traces triggered spoken and unspoken reactions that intensified the sense of communication. I see you. I see that you see me. How do you see me? How do I want to be seen and represented? Do you want me to see and represent you like this? The third, making across distance was an alternative form of hanging out that deepens the relationship between the researcher and researched. The time required to take photographs, make sketches, or produce a finished painting in singular sessions offered the opportunity for deeper engagement. And I think very important here is when you do an interview, you speak all the time and then somebody responds and all that. When you do participant observation, as we call it in anthropology, you don't talk all the time. You just accompany somebody, maybe to a church or to a gathering or whatever, sport match. And that's very hard to reproduce online. But this is one way in which you can just share time and then let the conversation flow or let silences happen. So the time required to take photographs, make sketches, or produce a finished painting in singular sessions offered the opportunity for engagement. Mia and I, for example, took time to tune into each other, sharing emotions of silence, creative activities, holding our work in progress up to our computer cameras, explaining what we were doing, and discussing themes related to my research interests. My discussions with all the women focused on their relationship with media technologies, their pre-pandemic and newly developed domestic routines, and new engagement with neighbors and the local environment. And in this kind of slow research, you might call it, all sorts of emotions can emerge. Fourth, our engagement comprised synchronous and asynchronous affective entanglements, as Skype visits were interspersed with WhatsApp messages. Digital technology enabled me to send photographic and painted images to the women and enabled them to provide feedback in the form of messages and emojis. This process did not only add layers of meaning and impact, but also encouraged ongoing communicative exchange that was both intertextual and intergraphic. This is just a painting of the setup of the scene. So digital traffic across different devices encouraged new visual and textual combinations and appropriations that I also explored in my paintings. This is a painting on my mobile phone, and some images and texts exchanged between Mia and myself. The photographs sent by Mia of her newborn child, and my response in the form of, again, emojis and short texts. But that's also interesting, sort of emotional dynamics enabled by communication technology and of course limited by it as well. And then the idea of emojis is emotional kind of expressions. So I also asked the women to create a photo diary of their pandemic lives, expecting that the photographic account would draw attention to themes that had not come up yet during previous encounters. Marius Quint noted that photographs, and I quote, can serve memory, as they can stimulate remembering, bring back experiences which otherwise would have remained dormant, repressed, or forgotten, and form records that store information beyond individual experience. And I think this is also a method that would be great, I think, to use in your research on these product aspects. As a personal interpretative visual series, the photo diary has strong affective value, enabling focused discussion and reflection. In the context of the pandemic, the method allowed the interlocutors to invite me to their homes and visually share practices and experience. So it is June 2021, and I again meet on Skype with Mia to talk about her photo diary. A few days ago, she sent 10 photographs to my mobile phone, and I'm now holding them up one by one to my laptop camera. The serial nature of the images means that we can return to them in different orders as we talk. As usual, she smiles easily, but I detect an underlying wariness during the course of our conversation. Her first photograph, made in May 2020, reflects an upbeat mood. It shows a brightly colored painting that she made of a group of beer-drinking, bantering friends during a virtual meeting. When I ask her to describe the image, she recalls how much she and her husband enjoyed the online parties with friends during the start of the first lockdown. This was a time when they, and all of us, expected the pandemic to be over soon. The text, at home, waiting for spring, plants to grow, flowers to bloom, staying connected together, expresses her sense of hopefulness. Mia's online parties are a good example of how she and her distant friends and also relatives dealt with the new sensorial reality of social distancing, where communication technology was crucial to their digitally mediated experiences of visual and sonic sociality. The lack of shared taste and touch did not stop the sense of togetherness. Irving wrote about sensorial perception that, and I quote, combinations of smells, sights, sounds, tastes, and textures continuously impress themselves onto the nervous system. But at the very same time, a person transforms and modifies the environment through their thoughts, movements, and actions. As such, both the perceiving organism and inhabited environment are in a process of constant change and adaptation through which life and personhood is individuated and expressed. And I think this quote also resonates with this notion of affective relationality. So Mia reshaped her social environment within the boundaries of possibilities and limitations inherent in the available communication devices. Initially, she enjoyed the challenge and felt that online communication was a good alternative to face-to-face meetings. Her mood changed, however, when she realized that the crisis would not be over anytime soon. So she says, things became much harder during the second lockdown, when our friends who live in countries that did not implement severe restrictions at the time could not identify with our situation. I felt increasingly isolated because I missed my friends and the excitement of doing fieldwork. It was also winter and dark, so it was really hard. Her photograph of a caged bridge reflects her desperation. So she says, this is the bridge that we normally cross when we go out on our daily lockdown walk. While the image refers to the phrase, there's light at the end of the tunnel, it also shows that I felt stuck, locked in. The symmetrical composition of crisscrossing bars powerfully visualizes the experience of spatial constraint. She adds that the cage is very symbolic of the lockdown situation and the way in which it ruined my plans. Not being able to continue with my research, having to cope with travel restrictions and the risk of infection made my life come to a standstill. So various scholars have explored conditions of endless waiting and existential stubbornness. The inability to move across geographical borders, increase social economic status, and continue one's personal development. Researchers have focused, for example, on the frustrated life ambitions of undocumented migrants, on disadvantaged youth, and on homeless men. While Mia felt stuck, her situation was, of course, radically different to people in such precarious positions. As a funded PhD student, we knew that at some point she would be able to return to her research. She was in a privileged position. The sense of aimlessness, however, affected her life negatively. So instead of waiting in limbo, she decided to start a family instead of waiting until she had her degree. The anticipation of parenthood re-energized. The 9 months countdown gave them a new sense of power and provided a personal timescale with their beginning, conception, and end, the birth. This did not mean, however, that Mia had escaped her sense of isolation, which she makes clear when we look at the next photograph, the hospital waiting room. So in their research on lockdown dynamics in Macau, Dennis Zwef and Kevin Hanna used the term anxious immobilities to explore experiences of social distancing, rising infections, and anxiety. And thinking about it, I think that in terms of migration, and especially during the Cold War, with people, refugees going from communist Eastern Europe and settling abroad without the possibility to come back, anxious immobility might also be useful. And I know firsthand because my father, he left Czechoslovakia in 1948 as a refugee and ended up in Holland. But the term can also be used to explore Mia's feelings when she had to spend long periods in hospital rooms on her own, waiting to be called for prenatal examinations and scans. The risk of contagion disallowed her husband to accompany her. Mia visualized her feelings in a photograph taken during one of her hospital visits, this one. The space is normally buzzing with activities, eerily empty. Her voice breaks when she says that, and I quote, "It was so hard to do so much on my own, going for tests, going for scans. My husband was there for the actual birth. He could not come with me afterwards to abort. It was lonely and depressing. I was in pain and I did not want to disturb the midwives who were stressed and rushed. In normal times, I would have been with my husband and my mother would have gone to Germany. None of that was possible. Having a child brought me closer to my mom, but she wasn't there. Before, I never really missed her. Now, I just wanted my mom. Now, I had not realized how hard it had been for Mia to carry and give birth to a child during the pandemic. And the photo diary clearly encouraged her to visualize and discuss these feelings. And I think this is really important because I've done many interviews with her online and done this painting and all that, but these kind of feelings have not appeared. So maybe partly because of this photo diary method, it just came into the picture. And of course, we have been building trust, although we haven't had met face to face, but because I combined methods, we had a sense of ongoing relationship. Okay, so I've come to my conclusion. I can make it long or short. I think I'll probably make it short because it's more interesting to discuss if we have time. But basically, the global pandemic produced a situation of immobility in which a globally spreading coronavirus forced large numbers of human beings into spatial immobility as they attempted to counter its deadly impact. Like many others across the globe, the migrant women central in my research relied on communication technologies to move around in virtual worlds to meet up with distant kin. The digital activities co-constituted an affective environment in which human and non-human agency shaped existing and newly emerging routines of virtual sociality and care. And just a point here about the idea of continuing dynamics. In my earlier research, this research in the pandemic has just been involving 6 women. But the earlier research I did in 2010 on transnational family life and the use of communication technology to show care that included over 100 interlocutors. So, of course, it was at a time when nobody used Skype or only a few, and it was a lot was also done by post and telephone calls. But it's clear that this long distance care and emotional interaction is possible using those kind of technologies. So the unique situation can be understood as a triad of interacting affective forces that manifest in themselves as the dynamic assemblages of people, devices, and in this pandemic case, viruses, because it was a clear force that shaped the interaction. I conceptualized the process as a relational field in which individuals continue to support in a changed social, spatial, material, and viral environment. Not only on drawing on pre-pandemic discourses, practices, and embodied experiences of transnational family love and care, but also reacting to the specific opportunities and limitations posed by the lockdown and the available technologies. And I ended with these two photographs next to each other to end with a sense of hope. As you can see, the swings have been populated with children once again. Thank you.